Well, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to CANDU's Links to Learning this fine Tuesday afternoon. I hope wherever you're joining from that you are well. I hope you are finding moments of peace and calm. I know December is a pretty busy month. It's the end of the year. It's the holiday season. So much is going on, but I hope in the midst of it all, you're able to find that good balance. So we're glad that you're here. We're glad that if you're not here, you might be catching this on the replay. So we say to you, welcome. We're happy that you've joined us. So my name is Michelle. I'm honored to be here. I'm joining from Amiskwichi, Waskaigan, Treaty 6 territory, known as Edmonton. We got a pretty cloudy day here today, but nonetheless, Creator's good. And so we acknowledge the goodness that Creator brings to each and every day. So take a moment, think of three things that you're grateful for in your day. Say you've already had a really good week, or maybe you've had a really tough week. Sometimes the December season can be tough for some of us. So even if in the toughness and the struggle that you might be feeling, just kind of reach out and look at those three things that you're gonna say thanks for. There's always something to give gratitude for. So that sun rose in the east this morning. So that's Creator meeting us for another day. And here we are in Tuesday, mid-Tuesday afternoon. And we are gathered together in this virtual community, and we're here to listen to Ronak. And he is the program lead with the capacity building and the sustainability services department at Alberta Municipality. So welcome, Ronak. We're glad you're here. So just a couple of housekeeping items. We love to hear your feedback and your evaluation. Your voice is really important. So an evaluation link will be sent to you at the end of today's webinar. Please, we'd love for you to fill that out. And when you do, your name will be entered to win one of two $100 Visa gift cards. Now, who doesn't need that in their life? So fill out those evaluation forms. Throughout the presentation, there might be an opportunity, or you might have some questions or comments. Feel free to use that chat box. And also just note, there'll be plenty of time at the end of today's presentation for any comments, questions, you know, experiences, stories that you may have about today's topic. So we'd love to hear your voice and your questions and comments. So today's webinar is Capacity Building for Climate Adaptation. Oh my goodness, I'm just not working my words well today. So let's try this again. Capacity Building for Climate Adaptation and Resiliency in Communities. So the Government of Alberta has provided $4.5 million for the Municipal Climate Change Action Centre, a partnership of Alberta Municipalities and Rural Municipalities of Alberta, to develop and administer climate adaptation and resiliency programming. So this funding will enhance the ability of Alberta's municipalities and Indigenous communities within the province of Alberta to prepare for and respond to climate-related risks. We need this. This is really important. So looking forward to hearing more about this, Ronak. So this webinar will discuss key concepts of climate adaptation and resilience and the value of community climate risks assessment and adaptation plans. We will also look at some existing success stories, and I love the stories. So I'm looking forward to hearing those and preview the upcoming grant opportunities. It sounds really great. So Ronak, I'm so honored that you're here with us this afternoon. Thank you for lending your time and your knowledge and your expertise in this topic. So I'm gonna pass this virtual mic over to you, and we welcome you, and we're so grateful that you're here.
Thank you. Thanks so much, Michelle. Thank you, Elizabeth, and everyone at CANDU. I really appreciate today's opportunity to talk to everyone about capacity building on adaptation and resiliency. I think it'll be a good conversation. I'm thankful for the opportunity. First, I just want to recognize and acknowledge the land that I am on today. I'm presenting virtually also from the city of Edmonton, the lands on which Edmonton sits, and the North Saskatchewan River that run through it have been the site of natural abundance, ceremony and culture, travel and rest, relationship building, making, and trading for Indigenous people since time immemorial. I'd like to acknowledge the many First Nations, Métis, and Inuit whose footsteps have marked these lands for centuries and whose presence continues to enrich our vibrant communities. So again, thanks for having me today. Look forward to speaking with you and perhaps an opportunity to work together in a good way. You heard a little bit about our organization. So the Municipal Climate Change Action Center was founded in 2009, and it's a collaborative initiative between the two different municipal associations in the province of Alberta, as well as the government of Alberta. So we're used often as a delivery partner for different types of funding programs around climate action. Specifically, what we do is provide funding opportunities, technical assistance, and education to different types of communities, different types of community groups in Alberta. And we focused on helping them lower energy costs, reduce greenhouse gas emissions, and improve climate resiliency. A little bit about our work. In our 12 years, we've supported 721 community-led projects on climate action. These projects have saved an estimated lifetime reduction of over 500,000 tons of carbon pollution. We estimate that these projects will create over 600 jobs and will save about $104 million in their lifetime. Looking ahead for us, we hope to continue to support communities in climate action. We want to work with them to help reduce our collective impact on the environment while preparing for the climate impacts that are already here. So yeah, a little bit about me. My name is Ronak Patel. I work as a program lead on capacity building. What capacity building means to us are the different supports and services that we can offer to communities that focus on increasing their ability to act on climate change. You might infer from the impact stats that I just shared about my organization, we do primarily focus on projects that reduce greenhouse gas emissions, but I have been working on the development of a new program that's connected to adaptation or resiliency, which I'll be sharing a little bit more about later in the presentation. But I guess before we get to that, I do want to just cover some general concepts of climate adaptation and resiliency. I also want to talk about the basics of planning in this world. Off the bat, I want to say that there's no right way of doing it. Every plan will be unique, the same way that every community is unique, but I just have some maybe guidelines or suggestions that maybe are helpful. And a couple of examples of plans or projects. And then at the end, I'll talk about what we're hoping to offer to you soon. Actually, it's on the program that we're hoping to create isn't open yet. So you're getting a bit of a preview today. And I'd be happy to try and answer as many questions as I can, but also recognizing that the program isn't exactly open yet. So I'll have to be a bit careful on what I can say. So I'll start kind of generally with climate action. So in our global response to a changing climate, we kind of have two sides of an approach. The first side is, like I've talked about a little bit, climate mitigation, actions that reduce climate change. So this involves, taking away the amount of greenhouse gases that are in the atmosphere. We can either reduce emissions or store emissions. For reducing, typically we think about two ways. One is to increase the energy efficiency of how we currently produce emissions, or we can generate clean energy, which don't have emissions associated to them. We can also capture and store emissions by enhancing things that are called sinks. Natural sinks are things like a healthy ocean, a healthy forest, healthy soil that all can store carbon. There are also some man-made activities that store carbon, projects that pump carbon into subsurface reservoirs or convert carbon into other products. But the main sinks are those natural assets that we have in our world. So these types of activities are ones that reduce the rate of climate change. At the same time, we also need to think about adaptation or resiliency. These terms are often used together. In my worldview, I think they're a little bit interchangeable, but they're both about adapting to a life in a changing climate, which can mean, you know, involving or adjusting to what we are seeing with climate change or what we're expecting to see in future climate change. So the goal really is just to reduce our vulnerability to the harmful effects of climate change. There are maybe also have some opportunities to take advantage of any benefits that come with climate change. There are some ideas that in areas there'll be a longer growing season or increased yields. But overall, we know that the negative impacts of climate change far outweigh any positive ones. So to kind of say that in a different way, we know that the Earth's climate is changing. Some of this change is due to the natural variations that take place over time. But we know that increasingly so, human activities release heat-trapping gases into the atmosphere. Those warm the planet and contribute to the greenhouse effect. There are some significant efforts to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Right before the call, we were talking a little bit about what's happened in the latest conference of the parties, or COP26 meetings. But I would say that there's currently not enough being done. And some degree of climate change is unfortunately unavoidable. And this will have significant human, economic, or environmental impacts on our communities. So to be able to reduce the negative impacts of this change and perhaps take advantage of any possible benefits, people will need to adapt. So again, climate change adaptation or resiliency refers to the actions that reduce the negative impacts of climate change while taking advantage of potential new opportunities. When we think about this kind of work, there's kind of a proactive side and a reactive side. Proactively, we can think about the policies and plans that we currently have, the actions that we may want to tweak because we understand what's expected to change. There's also the reactive side, right? So responding to climate impacts, if we think about like extreme weather events, we're often reacting. So in most circumstances, being proactive or anticipating these actions will result in a lower long-term cost. It'll also be more effective in protecting people and protecting our environments. What are some of the impacts of climate change? There are a lot. I think most people would agree that the climate and the weather really impacts everything in our world. Some of the more primary physical impacts of concern are listed in bullets here. Permafrost thawing, particularly important in northern areas where we have built infrastructure or the built environments upon permafrost. And as it melts, that can create a lot of problems. Warming or prolonged drought, which in turn can make forests more susceptible to fires or insect infestations. We're concerned about the increased drying in the continental interior, reduced snowpacks, shrinking glaciers, all of these things that are impacting water. If there's water shortages to our human use, to agriculture, to other supply, that's a significant impact. We're worried about the increased frequency of heat waves and smog episodes, especially in urban centers where we have high populations and we have a heat island effect that can amplify those events. We're worried about the increased severity and frequency of extreme weather events, things like heavy precipitation, rain, snow. I think that is at top of mind, considering what's been happening recently on both coasts of this country. And those weather events can lead to things like flooding, which in turn have other health or infrastructure or economic impacts. And I think one of the other major ones is damage to the habitat, as well as the ecosystems themselves, and especially species that are a bit more vulnerable, and that can impact local economies or traditional ways of life in different communities. Myself, as a first-generation Canadian and a settler, I don't think it's appropriate for me to speak to specific impacts to Indigenous communities. Instead, I did find some information on the Indigenous Climate Hub. This is a website that's Indigenous-led. It's a national online platform for First Nations, Inuit, Métis people, communities, and other organizations to share, learn, and connect. If you're not familiar with what these folks do, I would certainly thank them for what they put out in terms of information. I would certainly recommend that you get in touch with them. They have lots of helpful resources and other information on climate change. And they have that Indigenous perspective, which folks like me don't have. So yeah, I'll thank them for sharing some important impacts. They state that climate change threatens the ability of Indigenous peoples and communities to exercise their constitutionally protected rights. That includes the rights to hunt, fish, and carry out traditional lifestyles, practices, and ceremonies. They state that Indigenous communities are more likely to experience the adverse effects of climate change in different ways. Things like having diets altered as a result of changing ecosystems and migration patterns, changes to modes of transport and pathways of transport, changes to cultural ways of life, the ability to access essential resources and services. They also state that climate change can pose a critical implication on Indigenous culture and livelihoods, especially around the transfer and use of traditional knowledge, certain elements of traditional knowledge that may be threatened by climate change are things like, you know, weather and climate indicators, the ability to understand weather and forecasts, ways of learning around that. There's concerns around sacred sites and ceremonies, which may be site-specific or rely on certain medicines or herbs or resources that are threatened by the effects of climate change. There's also concern that the intergenerational knowledge transfer that exists in communities can be disrupted by climate change in the event of extreme or emergency situations. So I hope that maybe provides some context for impacts, general impacts, as well as those that more are specific more to Indigenous communities. I do have a question to maybe the audience here today. I was just wondering if you had any insight on how your community is currently being impacted by climate change or maybe in the future. So perhaps if you have a thought or a comment, I'd invite you to comment in the chat or perhaps speak up, and I can pause here for a minute to see what folks here have to say. Okay, I'm not sure if I see anything in the chat. That's okay. I'll invite you to think about these impacts as we continue on in the presentation today. Oh yeah, here are a couple of things coming in. Perfect. Rising food costs. Certainly, thank you for that. Something that maybe I didn't mention directly. Mitigating measures. I'm thinking about, you know, the floods in the southern part of the province of Alberta, thinking about the fires in Fort Mac. So certainly important as well. Yeah, I'll encourage folks to type in that chat box if you'd like. And if you set your message to everyone, maybe we can have a bit of a side discussion there on impacts. But water levels in the Great Lakes, weather changes, fisheries, of course. Yeah, I think for me, as someone who lives in Alberta, we don't really think too much about sea level rise. But for those that are located on a coastline or by, you know, large bodies of water, certainly a huge impact there. Yeah, so I'll encourage folks to keep that conversation going, but perhaps I will continue along in the presentation. All right. I understand that the organization has a bit of an economic development lens. So I did want to share maybe some of the financial impacts. So this is a table from the Insurance Bureau of Canada. It's the top 10 highest loss years on record for extreme or severe weather. And you'll note that 2020, it ranks number 4. And if you kind of look along the list, some of the most damaging events, at least in terms of dollars, have been occurring more recently. We see 2019, 2018, 2017, 16, all making the list. Severe weather across the country of Canada continues to highlight the financial costs that exist, both for like insurers, this is from the Insurance Bureau of Canada, as well as the taxpayer. Things like the Fort McMurray fires, flooding in Calgary, these are really high value costs. Insured damages for severe weather events across Canada last year, $2.388 billion. That's the fourth highest since this list is since 1983. There's also a stat from a different insurance company overall on the globe last year. They estimated that natural disasters caused $270 billion of damage, which is significantly higher than previous years. So this kind of shows us that climate is changing. These events are becoming more and more common. In the previous slides, we talked about the idea that extreme weather events, their intensity and their frequency are increased by climate change. Climate change may not cause them directly, but it does impact how often they happen and how big they are when they do happen. Okay, so we'll move now a little bit into specific looking at planning. So I guess starting with the concept of, why plan? The first thing I think we kind of talked about already is that the climate is already changing. Science shows us that in the past 50 years, the province of Alberta has warmed by 2 degrees, and that there is a projection to warm by another 4 degrees by the end of the century. We know that communities experience the negative impacts under the conditions. Although it might be a global change in climate, the local nature of climate impacts mean that communities are often the ones that are on the front lines to ensure effective management of risks, protect safety of the people in the community, as well as promote economic sustainability. So we're seeing that weather patterns are increasingly unpredictable with increased intensity and frequency of extreme weather events. I think everyone's aware of these examples, again, recent flooding and severe precipitation events. So planning for climate change will make your community more resilient. It can reduce the social, environmental, and economic impacts, help save money. There are large gaps in our preparedness for climate change. That's demonstrated by recent weather events. So planning can help close those gaps. So what goes into a plan and kind of what do we get out? We are trying to understand how local climate and the natural environment is projected to change in the future. And that can help us prioritize the impacts that affect people, both in their health and their way of life. It can help us prioritize impacts to things that we've built, as well as things that are in the natural environment, and then with that, the economy as well. And the plan can also help us identify and implement local actions that manage the risks and opportunities. And that's what's increasing our local resiliency. Some tips or steps that I think are important in adaptation planning. I think the first one really focuses on the scope of the planning process. So I think I've seen plans that kind of focus on different types of scales, from very small scale on a single asset. An asset might be a site, a facility, a building, a piece of land. We also can go up in scale to multiple assets if that's a certain area, certain services, certain operations, perhaps like a park area, transportation networks, built environment, things like that. And then we kind of have the community-wide scale, which, it kind of encompasses all the things that I've already mentioned, but also looks at, homes or private buildings and ecosystem functions and services and the health and well-being of people and animals in those spaces, a kind of a look at the entire community or region as a whole. And this is kind of the area that we recommend communities look at, not just focusing on specific parts of their community, but overall how a community operates all together. But you may also want to do something that's a bit more specific, sector specific or theme specific, focusing on food security or agriculture or public health. Some of the comments I think that have come in kind of reflect that you might want to focus on a specific theme or a specific type of service or a specific type of critical infrastructure. We know that daily life and economy activity relies on different things. So we want to make sure we can focus when we need to. If you can't do community-wide, a specific theme might be best suited for your community. We also want to consider a couple of factors like the community size, the cost of doing this work, the timeline for doing this work, any demands that might be more on administration or staff to do. We also want to consider the engagement with the community, if that's talking to elders, to young folks, to knowledge keepers, whoever that might be. All of these things can have a balance between something that's very simple and quick to do or something that's more detailed and qualitative. There's not to say there's a right way of doing everything. There's a scale in between. You can kind of pick what's best for your community, but to at least consider that in your scope, I would say is certainly important. Another tip I think that's important for scoping is thinking about what types of information are useful. So we want to understand how climate is projected to change for thinking about, temperature, precipitation, how many days is it going to be over 3 degrees, how many days is it going to be really cold, things like that. Those are hard to model for, individual communities. There is a resource called the Climate Atlas of Canada. They do provide climate projections across the country. So that might be a good place to start in terms of understanding how climate is projected to change in communities. What they do offer are different types of models based on certain years. They'll give you a 2030 projection, a 2060 projection, and they can also give different projections based on what we understand to be a changing climate. So you might pick the 4 degree increase scenario. There's a 6 degree increase scenario, an 8 degree scenario. So different scenarios for the different things that may happen to our Earth. It's also important to understand the historical or traditional knowledge of the climate, what has been recorded or what has been passed down over time, because that can inform what's changing, and just general impacts of future climates, beyond just the direct temperature precipitation, what are the impacts to, agriculture or things like that. So understanding what information we want to collect is an important part of the scoping process. One of the other bigger steps, and I would say this kind of follows scoping, is assessing risks and opportunities. We typically can do this through something called a risk assessment. So this involves developing a climate impact statement or a climate impact scenario. We're trying to link the predicted changes in our local climates, a relative hazard or opportunity, and then the potential impacts and consequences for communities. So we're trying to, create a statement that reviews the historical events. We also want to make sure that we, again, talk to experts, talk to members of the community, elders, to understand their experience with weather and extreme events. And the impact statements can be validated by these people. Whether it's experts, elders, or other stakeholders, they can review what we've written and validate that to ensure that it reflects what the community knows. We also want to focus on defining some sort of threshold or barrier or like an intensity level for each identified climate hazard. And that will help us assess if it's, you know, if it has a high impact, or if it has a high likelihood of occurring in the future. You may have heard of these terms like, you know, once in a 100-year flood. What those mean is slowly changing. You know, we can't have a one in every 100-year flood every 2 years. That's not that meaning doesn't apply anymore. So climate risk really is just a function of the consequence of a climate impact event. And it's given it's, you know, its intensity and likelihood of it occurring. So to assess that risk, we have to determine the likelihood that it will occur. We also want to assess the severity of our statements. Again, like likelihood against severity. And that gives us some sort of measure of climate risk. And then we can present them in some sort of, you know, chart or a graph, perhaps something like a risk rated matrix that allows stakeholders to interpret and evaluate these results and make make decisions and prioritize accordingly. So our risk assessment can help inform the action plan, which brings us to the slide on the action plan. So really, you know, we're trying to plan for actions that address priority risks and opportunities that have been identified and evaluated. So first, really, the important thing is to identify the actions. So what can we do to reduce or avoid the harmful consequences of our climate risks that we've already identified? If there's any benefits, are we capturing those benefits? That can also be considered here as well. Those actions then can be evaluated against other decision-making criteria that can help prioritize for implementation. You know, if it's a cost concern, if it's a timeline concern, all those things go into planning for implementation. Then, of course, that gives us a way to characterize priority actions and develop a plan. So in our plan, we want to make sure we have detailed information, estimated costs, maybe timelines, you know, someone that is responsible for that work, any partners that we may want to involve. Those are all important details to have when action planning. Something that I think is common in these types of plans is some sort of a structure that organizes the actions into themes. They might have overlapping goals and objectives, but having a theme to develop actions around can kind of drive an overall goal or objective. So some example actions, you know, pulled from various plans. Again, I just want to preface this by saying, like, actions take many different shapes and forms, and they can include things that communities are already doing. So that's just to kind of preface this list, but some things that are an example are, you know, doing more research if you don't have enough information about the nature of a risk or what the costs or benefits are, you can continue your research or ongoing monitoring to help make, you know, decisions down the line. You may want to, you know, update or develop new policies, plans, things like that can, you know, help embed the idea of thinking about climate into all of our decisions. You may want to consider, you know, thinking about operations or maintenance schedules, modifying them to make sure that, you know, things are up to date and can withstand the impacts or events. You may want to consider thinking about, you know, new built environments or upgrading the built environments, thinking about infrastructure, you know, buildings, roads, things like that. Are they providing protection against climate risks? Do they have flood prevention? Do they have erosion control? Things that are needed when it comes to understanding and responding to the changes in climate. Example actions might include, like, increasing awareness and education to help communities better understand or maybe even, like, visualize the risks of adaptation actions. It also might go the other way. You might, you know, want to do increased work to do community engagement and understand what folks are thinking in terms of their own lens on this work. Another example, and this one I think maybe is something that probably already exists and continues to be worked on, is emergency management measures. Having a response plan, evacuation plan, hazard mapping, or perhaps even having some sort of early warning or alert system for extreme events. Again, like there's no right way to do an action plan, but some typical things that are written or are included in them for each priority action have information about, what type of action is it? Is it like a plan? Is it a policy? Is it an actual, thing that we're building? Having a timeline again, when will that action be implemented or initiated? Is it a short-term project? Is it a long-term project? If we can estimate costs, that can help us understand when we can do this. Is it a low-cost action? Is it a high-cost action? That can even help as well. Again, we want to make sure we can identify someone to be responsible for it. Is there a lead? Is there an organization that can be held responsible for ensuring that this action is being implemented? And then, if there's partners or stakeholders that are required in support of the action, both within the community or externally, those are important to include in a planning document as well. And then I think the last real big thing is if you have a plan, you should put it into action, so implementation, and really thinking about the idea of integrating the idea of resiliency into all of our decisions. We're not just, to kind of go back to a couple slides, we're being proactive, we're not just reacting. And it's also a suggestion from us that you evaluate a plan every couple of years, maybe every 5 years makes sense. So you're staying on top of it and making sure that your plan is being worked on and not just collecting dust on a shelf. Okay, so just a couple of examples here. I did pull them from across the country, but we'll also look at some more specific ones closer to at least me in the province of Alberta. But this is Tsleil-Waututh First Nation in BC. So they created a climate change resilience plan. It's a comprehensive all hazard plan community-wide. Many of the staff that work at this First Nation were involved, and they incorporated traditional knowledge, practices, and art into influencing the planning process. There's a link if you're interested. You can read through their plan. They are a coastal community, so there is a big focus on sea level change, but it's really guided by the community inputs and the community values for this First Nation. And they worked with KWL, a contractor, to help write this plan and understand the risks that helped guide the plan. This is a different example from Moose Cree First Nation, which is in the province of Ontario. They had they've had two phases of a project. The first phase was to do this impact and risk assessment. So they, they are trying to understand the observed climate change that's happening in their community. What are the impacts? What are the risks? What are the opportunities? In the document, again, which has a link, you can find information on, how they conducted surveys and interviews and engagement sessions with the people that live in this community. People shared that they see both a direct and indirect impact to weather and their homelands. Many of them shared that they have noticed that warming trend. They noticed that their summers are warmer and longer, and the winters are shorter and warmer. Falls are later, springs are earlier. And they've also noted that they have a pretty variable storm prediction. Storms are happening more frequently, more with a higher intensity. And that's a little bit different than the historical understanding of storms in this area. Then in phase two of the project, they took what was gathered by the community. They kind of confirmed its accuracy against what the projections say, and they helped identify potential actions for the community to adapt to climate change. So again, they heavily used the staff and community members in Moose Creek First Nation. And they identified 19 actions for the community. They themed these 19 actions into a couple of key categories. And hopefully you kind of see this parallel to what we've discussed so far. They outlined the actions into the categories of hunting, trapping, fishing, and gathering. Local access and connection around transportation, and with that, public safety, roads, homes and buildings, local infrastructure, and food. So these categories and the 19 actions within them focus on helping Moose Creek First Nation prepare for the impacts of a changing climate. An example closer to home, at least for me, this is Saddle Lake Cree Nation. They completed a water vulnerability assessment project. So they understood, tried to understand what climate change is doing to their source water, which is the lake located in their community. They completed a vulnerability assessment on it. And then with that, they tried to educate community members on the lake level. They introduced more robust water quality monitoring, and they identified some strategies or actions for adaptation in a plan. So this is maybe more of an example of a community project that focuses on a specific theme here on water security. They also made a short documentary. It's maybe 20 minutes. And you can view it there on YouTube. It's fairly interesting. I'd recommend having a look. This project was supported by Urban Systems, a consulting firm. This project connects into this Saddle Lake Cree Nation project connects into a program that's offered by the governments of Canada. It's called the First Nation Adapt Program. So if you're not familiar with it, this program provides funding to First Nation communities, those of which that are below the 60th parallel, to assess and respond to climate change impacts that are on community infrastructure, as well as disaster risk reduction. They work with First Nation communities to identify region-specific priorities. They focus on things that we've talked about: sea level rise, flooding, forest fire, droughts, fisheries, and winter road failures. They've flagged these categories as ones that are the most disruptive or costly and present significant challenges to meeting First Nation communities' infrastructure needs. They provide funding for a couple of different things: risk assessments of climate change impacts on community infrastructure or emergency management. They also fund development and assessments of efficient options, as well as cost-benefit analysis. So this is an ongoing program. It's been running since 2018. I pulled a couple of examples from the province of Alberta, and you can see here the fourth one from Saddle Lake Cree Nation was the one that we just looked at. And there are some other examples as well. One focusing on ecological knowledge and food security, from blood bands, an engineering study from Irmiskin Cree Nation. Some of these projects continue into later years. So here's a list for 2019, 2020. So we see a continuation of some of the projects, as well as some new projects. And then most recently from this year, 2020, 2021, we see a couple more projects. Again, those that continue from previous year, but also some new ones. Flood mapping, flood hazards, at the top of the list there. I wanted to kind of spend some time here just to show that this program is still open. Again, this is not something that we work on. This is from the Government of Canada. but they are continuing to accept project proposals from for the next fiscal year, for this fiscal year, 2021 to March 2022. So if you have a project in mind, and you can maybe have a short timeline to do so, you can access the information on the website, and there's also an email for their contact. But this perhaps gives a good opportunity to transition to what we're hoping to open soon, which is the Climate Adaptation Program. So this will be a program from the Municipal Climate Change Action Center. We received $4.5 million from the Government of Alberta to work with them in developing and administering this program. So this program has the ultimate outcome of enhancing the ability of Alberta municipalities and Indigenous communities to prepare for and respond to climate-related risks. Again, to repeat myself a bit, we know that extreme weather events are impacting Alberta, water resources, ecosystem, buildings, infrastructure, on top of the impacts to people and communities. So this program really is to help communities understand, cope and manage to a changing climatic condition. We're hoping to kind of theme it around four points. We want to focus on broadening climate adaptation literacy. We want to help folks assess their vulnerabilities for climates. We want to help build plans as well as progress on risk reduction strategies. And these are all kind of themed around the idea of building capacity in a community, helping them understand what they need to do to help their people. So the plan is to open this program that has both advisory services and funding streams attached to it early next year. There's some activities under education, just kind of teaching basics around these topics. We'll do that through webinars and resources and things like that. We're also looking to host some sort of networking sessions, a community of practice for communities that are involved. We'll be doing case studies on existing projects, things like that. But the bulk of the money will be available as a funding support. So we're going to offer three different streams of funding. The first will focus on community-wide planning projects. So if you'd like for your community to have a plan, you can access funding for that. We'll also look to fund feasibility studies or analysis on specific resilience actions. So if you already have a plan, but maybe need some help getting your plan to completion, you can access funding for studies there. And then we'll also look to fund projects that use more of a traditional lens on this type of work. We are acknowledging that there's no like one way to do this kind of work. So if your community has something that's not described in the other two streams as an idea for a project, you can contact us and apply for funding through this traditional knowledge opportunity. So again, this program isn't currently open. We're hoping to open it fairly soon. So I hope you can appreciate a bit of a preview today. If you'd like to stay kind of connected on it, I encourage you to just visit our websites. We also do have an e-newsletter, and that's where updates go as well. So you can subscribe to that if you are interested in that. That's all I had to present. I know I maybe went a little bit over time, but there's maybe 10 minutes on the docket here still. Just having a look in the chat, I think there was a question that came in, I didn't see it. It was what specific prevention measures have been taken around the floods, the fires? So that's a great question. We see like these things happen and then we just react and then there isn't really a plan after. So I think that is one of the gaps that exists. So I don't know if there are specific prevention measures in place. I know in the southern part of the province, there's been the funding to help revisit some of the dams and reservoirs that exist. But I guess I'm hoping that what we're offering can help provide specific measures against some of these impacts happening again. So I hope that answers the question there. Yeah, I think so. I'm happy to send the links. Maybe I can forward that on to the folks I can do, and maybe you can forward that there. But I understand there's also being recorded as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Ronak, you can definitely send it to us, and we'll make sure all of today's participants will get, I believe, this PowerPoint, and then also any of the resources that you put in this presentation.
So. Yeah, of course.
Okay. Well, Ronak, thank you so much for spending about, 50 minutes with us talking about this very important topic. You know, when you asked halfway through the presentation about, the impacts of climate change, and I was sitting here thinking, because I live in, I live in the city, but then I actually thought about, a couple of summers ago when the fires were running rampant, and even this summer, but particularly two summers ago. And I remember going out to the land, and we had an elder there, and this was the first time ever, but he had a shotgun because he was like, the animal are coming this way, the bears, and where we didn't ever have that issue before. So, and then I was thinking about this past summer as well, and it was the hottest, in my opinion, in my my experience, it was the hottest summer. And we can go indoors, but then we think about our community who don't have that option to go indoors and find air conditioning, and the suffering that happened on the streets because of the extreme weather conditions. So you got me thinking about how it's impacted me as well. I'm a person who lives in the urban city, but also I understand that it does impact our Indigenous communities. The land and that connection, and the animals and the hunting and the fishing, that absolutely impacts that our livelihood. So thank you for this opportunity. So we have a couple of moments, everybody. If you have any questions or comments, we would invite you to unmute yourself, come on camera, or use that chat box. This is a good opportunity. And for that up and coming program that you're offering in 2022, right? I think that would be an excellent resource to look into as well. So any questions out there?
As usual, it's Ken again. Ronak, is there any organization, or is it your organization, that would predict heavy snowfall, heavy snow buildup, and a fast thaw? The heavy snowfall might indicate that there's not going to be as bad forest fires, but might indicate that there's going to be a chance of flooding. So early warning. So is there any, would it be your organization, or which organization would that be to let people know, like what's happened in BC, to give people weeks or months heads up? We've got a lot of snow buildup, and if we get a fast thaw, we're going to get flooding.
Yeah, great question, Ken. Thank you for it. So I know in Alberta, at least, the government of Alberta does have flood mapping available to communities. I understand that there's been some issues with accessibility to this information. I can't speak to that myself, but I know that this work has been done at some level, at least. I don't know if it's detailed enough to specifically help each individual community, but there are some existing flood maps that are there, and that can help inform an understanding of how does precipitation impact flooding. And then again, I think I've kind of used the same answer again for your other question, but we're hoping that the program that we're offering can help inform that. So if you would like to learn more about that, maybe you can work with a contractor or work with someone that you trust to do that work, understand that impact in your locale, wherever that might be, and make informed decisions to do so. So there are some things out there, but I think what we're hoping to do is cover that gap where it might not be available to you.
Great, thank you. A couple more minutes. Anyone have a question or comments before we go our ways? So just, in the chat box, Ronak, just to make mention, there's a whole bunch of thank yous for your presentation. We really value and honor your time and what you're doing. So thank you so much for being here, letting us know and giving us a preview of what's coming in 2022 and the resources and the excellent resource that will be made available for some of these communities. So thank you so much.
Yeah, of course. I know, you know, I maybe haven't shared too much about how the program will work, but you know, once it is open, there'll be, you know, a full guidebook that details, you know, what types of activities are eligible, and we want to get the funding out the door. So I also just dropped my email in there. So if you have follow-up questions, happy to connect. And you know, if it's January, February, the program's open, we can talk in detail about an idea you have, and I'm happy to work with you on submitting an application.
That's awesome. So then they would subscribe if they're really interested in knowing when the funding is open, to subscribe to that newsletter? Is that the way to kind of?
Yeah, that'd be a good way. I can also, you know, make a note here, and I can follow up with Can Do and, you know, let you guys know when the program's open, and then maybe you can kind of follow up with, I'm sure there's other folks not just here today that would be interested. So, you know, we'll make sure that everyone knows when it's open.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. And everyone, thanks for joining us this afternoon. We hope to see you again. Again, that you've joined Can Do Links to Learning. So I hope you have a good rest of the day. Maybe you go and honor, you know, your spirit, yourself first, honor the land, honor your relations, all that's around you. So be well, everyone. Take care.
Thank you, everyone.